there are a couple of people who I'd like to address the board in their turn at this point, and I'd call on, and this is Natalie Stoddard, if she'd come forward.
Madam Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I am Natalie Stoddard. I live at 3 Running Tide Road. Although I am not an abutter, I am pretty familiar with phase one of this area. My concern primarily, I am sorry to say, is the possible loss of some orchids, of which there are only 7 other occurrences in the state of Maine. It occurs about 50 yards long along the present dirt roadway in phase one, from approximately here to where the road bifurcates. It occurs on both sides of the road, along with fringed gentian, which is another rare, pretty flower. And any disturbance of that roadway area will destroy the plants. They are not transplantable. They simply will not survive. What they are growing in is Wisconsin last glaciation gravels, which are well graded throughout this area from pieces of the trash rock which underlies the entire area and comes to the surface in some places. The grain size in that Wisconsin gravel varies from quite coarse stuff down to clay sizes, which is impervious to water. Underneath that, in the lowland areas, this little raised area here and down here and out here, there is some peat, which again holds water like clay does when it gets saturated, but doesn't provide much drainage. There are a few interesting grasses and sedges around this end of that pond which might be preserved. There are ducks that nest in there. There's a fox den over here, and the area is generally trafficked by our neighborhood deer. I wouldn't worry too much about travel ways for the wild animals. They will simply go around what's in their way. And goodness knows we don't need to worry about the quantity of deer we have. They're all over. That sums up what I have to say.
Thank you, Mrs. Stoddard. Thank you.
And finally, I'd like to call upon someone who is familiar with the land and wishes to address the board on the subject of the wetland issues generally, Dr. Richard Sullivan, Red Sullivan, for those of us who know him well.
My name is Richard Red Sullivan, and I live at 72 Two Lights Road. And over the past 3 years, I've become very familiar with the terrain in the development, having walked over nearly all the land over this period of time. And I was very concerned with the initial wetlands map proposed by the developer, since I knew of several areas not addressed by the map. The first area was discovered by the planning board in our initial walk, and the experts over the past few days have identified a second area. I'd like to point out a third area of wetlands that I'm familiar with. As you pass along the public right-of-way and head up the hill, there is a fairly large area of wet soil, and I've gotten a wet foot there more than once in a number of different times during the year. So I would ask that second the motion that we need a very detailed wetland survey to include areas that perhaps don't initially seem to be wetlands, and ask that the planning board to instruct the experts to look specifically at this area in the middle of the field. Secondly, I anticipate that the developer may indicate that he has the option to pursue further test pits to try to find more suitable soils for the subsurface waste disposal. in observing his effort to date, I can testify that he has already dug a very large number of test pits in order to come up with the marginal soils that he has given to the planning board, and that I would anticipate that further efforts to try to find more suitable soils will be unacceptable and unsuccessful due to the pervading poor soils in the area. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sullivan.
That basically concludes our formal presentation. I'd like to just make a couple of conclusions, if I might. As we've gone through here, we've made a couple of some specific requests of the Planning Board for its consideration as it considers this project going forward. First, on the wetlands, there's no question that you have overwhelming evidence before you now that this wetlands saying, look, you can't even begin to know what the wetlands really are in here until you get in there when the frost is out of the ground, the snow's gone, and the leaves are back on the foliage is back there, and you can see what this to satisfy yourself as to the three tests, the water, the soil, and the foliage. And so our specific request to you on this issue is somehow figure out a way to get yourself an appropriate study next spring to find out where these wetlands are. Now, you have time constraints there, and I recognize what they are in the ordinance, given the 30-day clock that's ticking now. And so I guess the alternatives boil down to if the developer will not, or the applicant won't consent to that kind of an extension, then at this point our recommendation, our request to you would be to deny the plan at this stage. Secondly, on the subject of the soils, the evidence that we've given you tonight, which is the first you've seen of this. This is something that's not in any record before you before tonight, because this is something that normally would only be required at the state level. But because your ordinance cranks in that state level of review and information, this is the appropriate time for this board to say, show us how this is going to work, because our calculations show so far that you've got at least half of the lots now not working for subsurface septic disposal. You have another two to three, there's one that overlaps down here, that may not be buildable because of wetlands problems. In our scenario at this point, you've got 12 or 13 out of 20 lots that are in serious jeopardy. So at a minimum, the planning board at this point should request the applicant to provide you with the information that either confirms what Barry Timpson is telling you or figures out how he's going to solve the problem. Third, we do ask you, we renew our request to you, that the planning board, that the comprehensive plan be thought of as an integral part of what's happening here. You see marginal soils, you see marginal you see wetlands problems, and you see some traffic problems too because of the potential for the tourist problem. And this is one such case where you can point to your plan and say, this is what we're talking about here. And we urge you to do that and look at it in that light. And finally, on the subject of the traffic, we do think that you should have in hand something which tells you what can be reasonably anticipated by virtue of the creation of that new entrance on Two Lights Road, and how many tourists are likely to go down there out of the however many thousands of cars go down there during the summer. Some percentage of those is going to wind up in here driving around. And that is a number, and that impact on the safety of the folks living all through here, but particularly the people on Hunts Point Extension, is a very much an issue that is unresolved in the state of the record before you. And so we thank you for your time and your patience. There are in this audience a large number of people who I believe do wish to address the planning board quite outside of our formal presentation to you. I'd just like to ask everybody who's here supporting the positions that we've been taking tonight to stand up. Some of those you've heard from I think you're going to hear from a few more now. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Yes, Dr. Holt.
Well, my name is William Holt, and I just had a couple of thoughts that occurred to me during this most elaborate presentation, and I have to congratulate Mr. Plum on putting together a program pretty rapidly. There is, on the traffic were the two questions. I should point out that I live at the very, very farthest you can go down Running Tide Road at the very end, and I'm am in a butter in a, about 2,000 feet worth of a butter along one edge of phase one. But I'm not speaking of that. I really feel quite neutral with respect to the project per se. Before I lived where I live, we lived at 45 Broad Cove Road, and there certainly is a very great deal of traffic that goes in and out of the Broad Cove development. And those of us who have little children are keenly aware of that. And the points made by those who oppose the second entrance into Broad Cove struck me very hard, because this second road probably would ease a good deal of the danger to the children who now live along Broad Cove Road, which is an extraordinarily heavily traveled little road, and the first part of which many people enjoy going quite quickly on. I think it's one of Cape Elizabeth Police Department's favorite traps. While it's true it would be deleterious probably to residents of Hunts Point Road, there are many other residents in Broad Cove who perhaps welcome the thought of a second road. I've lived in that neighborhood since 1974, and during that time there have been at least three occasions in my memory when, if there had been a fire or a medical disaster in the distal half of Broad Cove development, there would have been an extraordinary disaster. In 1978, in that famous February storm, a brook overflowed and then froze, and for more than a day, it was impossible for vehicles to get at the distal one-half of beginning at Salt Spray and Broad Cove. I think the town of Cape Elizabeth, having heard for more than 20 years for the need of an access road, and having your planning board having heard testimony at one of your working sessions from both the fire chief and the police chief, the town, I think, needs a second way into Broad Cove for its legal protection. I can't imagine how Cape will defend itself if a disaster occurs while Broad Cove Road is blocked, and somebody can testify that we have heard for 20 years of the need for a second way in and ignored it. I think that needs to be heard. I'm neither in favor nor against the development itself, but I think the second access in the Broad Cove is a crying need. Thank you.
Dr. Holt, just to clarify, you want a second full access, not an emergency access. Which are you talking about?
Well, I suppose the second access, such that emergency vehicles would be able to get at it year-round, would meet my particular request.
I see. It's not a full access open at all times that you are proposing.
I guess I'm simply proposing that it's a very dangerous situation without a second adequate opening in.
Yeah, everyone agrees to that.
Yeah.
It's whether the access is a full one that is traveled every day, mm-hmm. or an emergency access.
Yeah, I guess I'd certainly have to defer to the planning board on that question. I guess the portion of this that I find personally attractive, and many of us do, is that it offers the town an answer to a 20-year-old problem.
Right. Thank you. Anyone else from the public? Yes, Louise.
Madam Chairman and members of the Planning Board, my name is Louise Sullivan, and I live at 72 Two Lights Road. There are a couple of issues about traffic on Two Lights Road that I would like to address tonight. One is the nature of Two Lights Road itself being long and straight. The police department has told me, and many of my neighbors who have asked them about keeping the speed down on that, they said it's very hard to patrol that road adequately to maintain the speed limit there. And so we have a lot of cars going very fast. The addition of almost 90 cars per hour at peak times would be a very great addition to the hazard that we already have, I think. And in addition, Two Lights Road, because it is so beautiful, has a lot of people using it recreationally. Walkers, joggers, people with animals, and, you know, babies. So people are using that space for other things than driving cars. Another 90 cars per hour would be, at peak times, would be a hard thing. Also, the turn up by St. Bartholomew's Church, I think, hasn't been looked at. That turn is very tight. There are several driveways that open onto it, as well as the back driveway of the church. And that is already a somewhat congested area. The road is narrow and there aren't shoulders there. If Two Lights Road were to become a real access road into Broad Cove, I think that particular area could constitute a clear hazard. In addition, the last issue of the Cape Courier reported something that's not news, which is that there were two deer accidents in the last 2 weeks on Two Lights Road. Those are common, and they're commonly reported in the Courier, but people hit deer on that road all the time. Additional traffic means additional hazards to the people in the cars and the traffickers. My last point is that there is a place in the road that's in between Richard Kennedy's house and the Poulin's house where the water covers one lane of the road whenever there's a heavy rainstorm, or in the winter when there's a thaw and a freeze is when it's particularly dangerous. And Public Works puts up sawhorses, and we all use, and lights, and we all use one lane of Two Lights Road during that time. This condition often exists for days at a time, and everybody is careful. But you add the scenario of more cars going quickly and competing for that one lane, and I think that you see that it could be a dangerous situation for the people in cars there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, in the back. I'll take this gentleman first, and then you can follow him. How's that? Good evening.
Good evening. Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Board, my name is Bruce Gasquet. I live at 82 Hunts Point Road. First, before I even get started here, I'd like to thank you all as our guardians of planning in this town for doing a great job that you've done so far. We request your indulgence with this. I'm a direct abutter. If I can show you here at 82 Hunts Point Road, to where the proposed road will run from Two Lights into Hunts Point Road Extension. I don't know if the Planning Board is aware, but the entire side, south side of Hunts Point Road Extension suffers drastically at this point from soil erosion and runoff problems. Many of the residents on this side of Hunts Point Road Extension have mini lakes or swamps in their backyard at this point in time. We're very concerned about this project and what it may do to those erosion problems as they exist right now. My builder, Ibis Corporation, when they built my house, had to take elaborate precautions running the water course that exists here. There's a wetlands area where this proposed road will run through into Hunts Point Road Extension. They had to run special tubing underneath my house to ensure me of a dry basement, running this down into a drainage ditch that now exists on this side of the house. I'm very concerned if a road is put through at this point, what will happen to my property, what will happen to the soils, the drainage in my area, my septic system. I don't know if that has been addressed in Peter Kennedy's study. Certainly concerned also what will happen to all the drainage on the south side of Hunts Point Road Extension. And I would invite at some point, if you haven't done so already, that members of the Planning Board in the spring take a look back there after everything has thawed out and see what the soil erosion and water problems are back there. In addition, there is a drainage ditch that runs down to the southeast of my house, which I believe is proposed to be expanded and widened with this new project, there appear to be aquatic plants in that drainage ditch. I don't know if this is a natural occurrence or how they've gotten there, but you might want somebody doing a wetland study to also take a look in that drainage ditch. It appears to be a feeding ground for ducks in the springtime. But we do have concerns about what will happen to our septic systems with a possible expansion here with all these new lots going in, and I would like somebody to take a look at that. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gasquet. And the next gentleman.
Good evening, and thank you for your time. My name is Peter Barris, and I am also an abutter of the proposed road on 74 Hunts Point Road. I own one of the largest lots on the extension, which is over an acre, but a good third of that land is unusable due to wetlands, which a lot of it has already been marked with special markings for plants, and you can't even walk into it because it's swamp as of now. I am very concerned that I went through the walkthrough with many of you on the planning board and a lot of other concerned citizens. And where the proposed road is located, it's wetlands, and you're going to build over it. And one of the funny things that happened is everybody walks through that part of the property which I own. Everybody says, wow, look at how wet this is. But then in the next thing they say, but no problem, we can build over the road and we're going to drain it and it's going to be great. Well, my land, like I said, one third of it is basically drainage now. And I'd like to see how in a current study and without anybody going through this, especially if they're just going under what the snow and partial freezing of the land looks like, how do you know what the drainage is going to be and the effect of that road, especially when you're building over wetlands already, which everybody, when you walk through it, had to walk around it because the boots were wet. So I couldn't see how you could go any farther without taking a look at the impact study, waiting until springtime when you see the melt-off and see the true effect. Because as I say right now, a third of my land is wet, and with the road, I think it's just going to get wetter. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Barris. Anyone else from the public? Yes.
Madam Chairman, members of the board, I'm Sylvia Costopoulos, and I've lived at 28 Broad Cove Road since 1969, when it was a quiet road. And though I appreciate so much what all the people from Two Lights and Hunts Point Road are feeling, believe me when I tell you, we also have children, in my case, grandchildren, and we live in horror that they will step out of our door and anywhere near Broad Cove Road, because it's impossible, absolutely impossible, to be on that street with the traffic right now. We need a second access route desperately. A year ago, we had a lightning struck a tree in front of my house, and a wire was hit by that branch, and it hung precariously over the electrical wire, stopping the traffic for a good 30 minutes. We couldn't go in and we couldn't go out. Now, this was a simple thing, but it's only one thing, and it's just a matter of time before we do have an incident in Broad Cove where people will not be able to get in or out in an emergency. To me, it's ridiculous that we don't have another access route. And I invite all of you to come and sit in my driveway if you want to have an adventure and attempt to back out, because it's fascinating to see how easy it is to commit suicide going out of my driveway this morning, really, or taking a walk on Broad Cove Road. Any time of the day now is just really impossible at that end. I thank you very much for your time, and I truly hope you'll consider that it is a danger to all of us not having another access route into Broad Cove.
Once thank again, you. Mrs. Costopoulos,
yes.
Are you proposing a full
absolutely
access route?
Absolutely, I am. I think we need a full road coming in, another access route into Broad Cove.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes, Mr. McGovern.
Good evening, Madam Chairman, members of the board. My
Good
name
evening.
Is Michael McGovern. Pursuant to your rules, I'm a resident of Mitchell Road here in Cape Elizabeth. As all of you are aware, I do support the opening of a full access road, additional access road out of Broad Cove. I sent you a memo on this. It was about 3 days before the beginning of summer. And here we are just a few days before the beginning of winter, and you're still debating this question. There are many quote possibilities there, but I'll avoid them all. Anyway, my reason for proposing an access road are essentially based on four distinct points. First, public safety standards as contained in present ordinances as well as past incidents imply the need for a second access from this neighborhood. Second, emergency access roads, simply as emergency-only roads, do not work over the long term. Third, the history of the Broad Cove subdivision has always been premised on the belief that a full access road would be constructed. And fourth, it is rather utilitarian point, but it's the fact that traffic will decrease in nearly all of Broad Cove as a result of a second access road. The first point, public safety standards. Just 2 years ago, this planning board proposed to the town council new subdivision regulations. I'll quote from those regulations proposed by this board. The board shall require the streets be designed so as to provide safe, convenient, and attractive access from the subdivision to previously existing or proposed public ways, which may include two or more means of access. The subdivision regulations also provide in section 16.32A9 that, it, quote, in no instance shall a dead-end street exceed 1,000 feet in length and service more than 20 dwelling units. Today, Broad Cove is essentially a 1.8-mile dead-end with over 200 homes. You received an opinion from the town attorney's office just today. It came over the facts, which states that in no instance means in no instance, that the waiver provisions, according to the opinion of the town attorney's office, do not apply, that the specific language would appear to carry. I think it's interesting that the original standard for dead-end streets of the town of Cape Elizabeth were developed as a direct result of Farm Pond Road back on March 19th of 1970. Therefore, when the town council enacted the current ordinance, I think you can take the legislative intent that it was intended to apply in this instance and should not be waived. Additionally, in the public safety area, as early as 1973, then Fire Chief K. Wayne Murray brought to the planning board's concern, as well as the town council, the need for a second access to Broad Cove as well as to Shore Acres. He wrote it again in 1976. In 1978, Fire Chief Charles F. Wilson wrote to the town council on the issue. Replacing Chief Wilson was Chief William H. Jordan. Bill Jordan's never been too much of a letter writer, but I think his views are well known on the fact that he, as fire chief, always supported an additional access. Mm-hmm. Additionally, Fire Chief Donald Webster spoke to you recently at a workshop and indicated that he also supported a full access road. I believe you also heard from Chief of Police David Pickering on this issue as well. Looking at this historically, I'd also like to quote from a letter, actually it was written on my 21st birthday, some 12 years ago, from the president of the Broad Cove Association. Then President Richard Williams wrote to the planning board, quote, already there is not another area in Cape Elizabeth with so many families are dependent on a single access road. In the fall of 1976, the association took a census of our area. The census showed that there are 124 households and a population of 527. And since the census was taken, the aforesaid numbers have increased. The potential for traffic consequences in the event of fire or other emergency is compounded each time a residence is added without further accessibility to the main road. And he goes on, we could go on at some length about the dangers, and I have not even mentioned the most dangerous situation of all, the dangers posed to the 252 children living in the area. These dangers come from excessive traffic on an already overworked road system and large construction trucks barreling down the road to get to homes being built in the furthest portion of the areas. This is 1977. Of course, we know there were 124 homes then. It has almost doubled since that point. In the memo in June to you, I also pointed out the fire that occurred on May 5th, when for over 1.5 hours, there was absolutely no access to Running Tide Road, to Hunts Point Road Extension, and to a portion of Hunts Point itself, as well as to Maysfield Terrace and Winding Way. In the memo, I also pointed out the preponderance of doctors that live in the Broad Cove neighborhood. We're not only talking about the safety of the people in that neighborhood, we're also talking about the need for all of the doctors in that neighborhood to be able to get out to respond to another emergency. I realize there are other doctors that can respond to calls, but I think it is something that you should be that you should consider.
Excuse me a minute. While someone is talking, I think it would be advisable to listen, okay? Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'd like to move on to the next point, and that's regarding emergency access roads not working over the long term. I think you see this nowhere more clearly than Farm Pond Road. Farm Pond Road was established in 1970 as an emergency access road. I would challenge anyone today to try to get in and out of Farm Pond Road for emergency access to Broad Cove. That was a requirement of the planning board. I think that's just one example of emergency access roads not working. There is another one down to get out of Wildwood that was approved much more recently by the planning board. We took pictures there this summer of three boats that were parked blocking the access road, a very convenient place for someone to put boats. As of this point, it is still not plowed. There was another one very close to my home to get out of the Hubstone subdivision, also approved in the 1980s. There's usually a car blocking that, and I've never seen it plowed at any point, and I drive by that at least twice a day. So I would suggest that the alternative of an emergency access road is not one that has worked well over the test of time, that you not consider simply an emergency access road. Third, I think you need to look at the Broad Cove history, in that back in 1968-69, when Running Tide Road was approved, when part of Hunts Point Road Extension was approved, as well as Maysfield Terrace, it was the planning board's intent at that time to require a full road out to Two Lights Road along where Farm Pond Road is. Apparently, they made an error when they actually passed the motion, and they failed to put that in the condition. But I have two pages of excerpts of minutes that make it very clear that it was the desire and the intent of the planning board, and it was simply an error when they passed it, and it was something they tremendously regretted right away. My point about traffic decreasing in nearly all of Broad Cove, we did some traffic counts in August and September of 1988. It was alleged in a letter you received that it did include traffic coming from St. Bartholomew's Church. That was, in fact, incorrect. Those times were not included in the calculations of when church traffic might have been coming in and out. But regardless, it shows that right now, or at least back then, there was an average daily traffic going in and out of the main Broad Cove entrance road of 1,885 vehicles per day, which is certainly a considerable amount of traffic on the feeder road that is. On that point, I should mention of looking, if you look, unfortunately this isn't a good map, but right now all of the traffic is going in and all of the traffic is going out, thus putting double the burden on the number of roads. If, as the analysis shows, that the break point of where the traffic would go in one direction or the other is approximately the intersection of Hunts Point Road and Salisbury Lane, what will happen is that area right down there, particularly Salisbury Lane, will eliminate all the traffic coming from the other end of Broad Cove down near Running Tide Road and Maysfield Terrace. So, in fact, most of Broad Cove, all through there, will see a reduction of traffic. Similarly, even on Hunts Point Road itself, further up, you won't have all the traffic coming out. So it's only at a point when you get up very, very close to the Running Tide Road, the Winding Way Hunts Point Road extension, Hunts Point Road intersection, that you actually begin to have more traffic. And on this proposal is currently coming from the developer, it's only really Hunts Point Road extension that actually has more traffic, because there's just as much traffic coming out Winding Way, going up this way, being diverted out, as there would be coming going from the other direction. So in fact, there is in fact a reduction. On that point, I heard Mr. Plum, Peter Plum, make the comment that there's going to be all sorts of tourist traffic coming in. And again, you look at that point, you'd have to double the tourist traffic that there currently is of people going in and out in order to have a net positive effect. there are two streets that I think in Cape Elizabeth that are similar now and that go through, both very, very close to a park facility, and in this case, it's in the instance of Fort Williams Park. One of those is Surf Road, and the other is Seaside, Seaview Avenue, both off of Shore Road. Both of those names very clearly tell me there's something to go see down there. And yet, neither of those streets, which has all of the traffic going to Portland Headlight, has traffic going down of any amount sightseeing. So I think the argument that you're suddenly going to be getting 2,000 cars turning left and right into Broad Cove Road just to look at Broad Cove Road, who don't have any other business going there, just isn't accurate from our other experience. I could go on. I think my points and my views on this are well known. It is something, again, that has gone on for well over 20 years, has been a position of the planning board and the town council. I think the ordinances clearly require it. I don't have a position on the subdivision itself. I believe, that's clearly within the purview of the planning board, and I'm glad I'm not the one that has to review every last detail of it. There has been some comments on whether or not Farm Pond Road might be more acceptable than this extension coming out this way. From the beginning, my preference has been that the road go out the proposed location from the very beginning, which is the original Farm Pond Road intersection. But yet, I realize the planning board has many different issues to look at, and wetlands and some other issues.
And orchids.
Orchids. And, I would hope that you would consider that and continue to take a look at that. Mm-hmm. My concern is that if a development is approved, that there is a second access road. And my preference is that it is Farm Pond Road, but either one would be perfectly acceptable.
Good. Michael, while you're there, could I just ask you a question? You talked about emergency access roads that didn't work in the past. Most of those are gravel roads, are they not, or gated roads? Recently, we received, I guess it was the last time, a lengthy letter from Dr. Richard Sullivan, who proposed an emergency access road that would be paved, connecting Hunts Point Road to Two Lights Road. It would be paved and marked emergency access only. It could be used at all times. It would be left open. It would be a town road. It is not a private road. What do you think of that proposal as a compromise in this very controversial situation?
I haven't seen Dr. Sullivan's letter, first of all. He didn't provide a copy to me.
Well, it's a matter of public record because it's in the record.
I have not reviewed your entire record on this issue. My feeling on an emergency road posted but it would be open is that it, for the police to enforce it, I'm just not sure how they could do it. Road regulations, traffic regulations under the town ordinances and charter are determined by the town council, not by the planning board. I think the more appropriate forum for consideration of a proposal like that is the town council and not the planning
board. Well, since the planning board only recommends roads, the town council will decide in the end about this road, will they not? They can accept or reject town roads if it is a town road. So anything that the planning board does on the road is merely a recommendation, so to speak.
If you had no road at all proposed, chances are this would not go to the town council. There wouldn't be an issue before them.
Right.
They would only be requested if there was a public road proposed, to agree to accept it upon its satisfactory completion. Did I answer your question?
Sort of.
Okay. Yeah, but I think, a more direct answer to Dr. Sullivan's suggestion is, there's the issue of enforcement and how would it be enforced, but there's also an issue of use of public accommodations. And I think attorneys could address that far better than I can, but when you have public facilities and you have discriminatory patterns of usage, I think you raise certain civil rights and other issues.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else from the public? Yes, the gentleman in the back.
Madam Chairman and board members, I'm Dan Spratt, and I live at 123 Pheasanton Road with my wife. And as you can probably guess, I'm concerned about traffic into the Two Lights, Pheasanton Road, Kelco's area. And listening to the problems in Broadcove area and problems on both sides, it makes me more worried about the problems that may be created by opening a full access road, not an emergency access road, to our area, maybe alleviating but not solving one problem and creating another problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. It's Dan Spratt?
Spratt.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else from the public? Yes.
Hi, I'm Mary Alice Riley.
Hi.
And I live on Two Lights Road. I've lived here 20 years, was in Broad Cove previous to that for 10 years. Back to the wetlands issue, I think I can explain part of the problem here on the back part of my property. There used to be a pond, which, unknown to me, was drained just a few years ago before this previous owner, owner now. I didn't know about it. There's a ditch there. It drains, and it continues to drain. It was a place where the ducks always used to go after our front pond dried up. I believe the pond has been there a long time because Rainey Jordan, our neighbor, the owner of this Phase 1 property, previous owner, used to tell a story that his father owned the land and had a team of horses that got into this pond and they couldn't get it out, get the team of horses out, so it's still there, I guess. So my point is, I think the pond has been there for a long time and probably the water will continue to be there. And that's most likely where it all drains down into here.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Riley. Anyone else from the public? Yes.
My name is Edward Perry. I live at 10 Pine Ridge Road. I own these two lots right here, and the maps always show the two buildings that both belong to us. I have some concerns again about the marginal soils. From tonight, we've all heard that many of the lots probably have marginal soils on them, and I consider that my two lots have marginal soils, and I'd just like to relate some of the experiences that we've had on our land. Much of our lots, this is the only time of year we can walk on them because they're frozen. The rest of the year, if you don't have boots on, you can't walk. On the path that's been turned into lawn, standing water remains until June or July. And I guess that's because of the marine clay and ledge that's underneath that just does not allow the water to drain down. Our septic system never really worked right. And although we didn't want to go onto the sewer, the smell and the fact that I couldn't get the lawnmower across the top of the septic system without sinking in made us finally decide to go onto the sewer, even though we didn't want the added expense. Our house, luckily the builder foresaw the problem and they put drainage pipes under it. So we have a dry basement. But ironically, I think our house is going to be in the same situation that many of these houses would be in. We have one end of the house that floats up and down while the other end of the house stays still. And the result is we have large cracks in our foundation walls that allow water to flow out across the garage in the spring. And my father and I get out the mortar every year and drive out here and repack them. Our sills have lifted off the foundation walls,
to the point where we take other 2x4s and pack them in between the sills and the foundation walls. Inside the house, we have constantly moving sheetrock, which doesn't allow us to paint many rooms. We've wallpapered them, but the wallpaper rips and tears, so that doesn't look too great either. Second building here that I always get a kick out of it because it makes it look like, oh yes, there are other houses here, but this is a storage barn that we couldn't build a house on this lot. It was too wet. There was no way we could put a septic system on it, and so we ended up putting a storage barn with no plumbing at all. This situation makes me wonder about the wisdom of approving a subdivision with so many marginal soils in it. I also question the fact that, now I'm not exactly clear on this, but I've heard this, that some of the lots are approved for 2-bedroom houses only. So I thought that was interesting that what's going to happen 5 or 6 years down the road when the house is actually built and the people come in, is somebody going to be there and say, well, you can only put a 2-bedroom house here and don't ever change it because your septic system will not handle anything else. I don't think that's a realistic approach. I also have another point. My wife and I are both fairly conservation-minded, so we didn't mind leaving a lot of our lots unchanged. We enjoy seeing the wildlife and the deer that come into the yard. I think that from looking at the plan, we see that a lot of other residents are going to be in this situation. And I'm just wondering whether they will also be as conservation-minded, that what will happen in their lots? Will they have easements written into the fine print of their lot saying that you can never cross this line and do anything with the wetter part of your land? I wonder what will happen 5 or 6 years from now when they actually build a house on some of these lots, since the building schedule is projected 7 to 10 years, I believe. Are the pink flags that right now so clearly mark all the wetlands, are they going to be there for a bulldozer operator to go around and know exactly where to go and know where not to go? My whole family has walked on this property many times. It's very beautiful. I'm sure it's suitable for some kind of development, but I just don't think right here this particular configuration is the appropriate one. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Perry. I'd like to just stop a moment and tell the planning board that it is now 10 minutes to 10. What are the wishes of the planning board? Do you want to continue this for a certain amount of time? Mr. Balfour was supposed to be on at 9:30. Do you want to take this entire process to the next time? What does the planning board wish to do?
Yes. Madam Chairman, can you get a sense from the people that are here tonight how many additional speakers we might have, and that might dictate?
Yeah, because I want to give everyone a chance, but I think the applicant also has Mr. Bray here, and I know that the planning board has many questions. What do we do about Mr. Balfour, who has been waiting? You have all got to help me. How many people here still wish to speak on this issue? One, two, three, four, five people. Six, seven, eight. Boy. Eight at this point. You know, we could extend this public hearing to the next meeting. Thank you. I should have said you may sit down after we counted you.
Madam Chairman, yes. I have a question in procedure here. Mm-hmm. We've heard a lot of comments from the public. I'm just wondering, when the applicant gets up to speak and give us some response, are we going to be able to put the two together, so to speak?
Yes. Well, Steve and
that's one problem of going lengthy time. I guess maybe some proper reading of the minutes or something could be done to get us up to speed on the issue. But we should consider that.
Mm. Dick?
Madam Chairman, a suggestion. We do have a provision for continuing a public hearing process, and there are, I'm sure, a lot of the questions that have been raised tonight that the applicant wishes to address. He may, in fact, want to take some time to think about some of those answers or any of the issues that have been raised. If there are 8 or 10 people that still desire to speak, we could be here for at least another 20, 30 minutes,
right.
And then presumably 20 or 30 minutes of applicant responses. And Mr. Balfour is here for his mm-hmm. portion of the agenda.
Right.
We do have rules that require us not to take up an item after 10 o'clock.
Correct.
Notwithstanding what happens with the public hearing this evening, I would hope that we could continue with Mr. Balfour's request at
right.
whatever time it is.
Right, if he's willing to wait.
If he's willing to wait. But I would propose that we might consider adjourning the public hearing to our next meeting
mm-hmm.
and then take 8 or 10 public inputs and then spend some good quality time with some answers.
Right.
To the questions and then our own questions of the applicant.
I think that would make a lot of sense.
I agree with that.
Yes.
I have a question, though, that I might like to ask if the lady is still here. Mrs. Stoddard?
Sure.
All right. Well, I'll try to retrieve the answer in another way.
Okay. So what are the wishes of the board? Do I hear, and I'm really sorry about this, Mr. Kennedy. I know you've had all of your resources with you this evening, but your application has certainly been met with an enthusiastic response to the public hearing. So I guess I would entertain a motion to extend the public hearing.
Madam Chairman,
to the next meeting.
I would perhaps, if it's appropriate, offer to Mr. Kennedy, if he has a particular desire to introduce Mr. Bray or some other
yes.
of his experts that will not be able to be here at the next meeting,
right.
perhaps.
We could
that,
take
that
some time
to
do
minutes.
That and ask Mr. Balfour to wait, and we will address his application shortly. Would that be all right with you? Mr. Kennedy, ask Mr. Bray to come up and...
if required.
I beg your pardon?
If he requires it, he may not.
Right.
Lack the opportunity, Mr. Bray, to make some statements. And
good.
When is the next meeting?
When is the next meeting? January...
It would be January 16th. I'll double check.
So I think we should have a motion to extend the public hearing at this point in time.
I would so move that.
Is there a second?
Sure. And if you could specify that it will be extended to January 16th, 1990.
Okay. Any discussion on that? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous. We'd love to hear from Mr. Bray if you want to.
Very good.
Welcome back, Mr. Bray.
It's been a long while.
Yeah.
A little warmer the last time I was here. Let me just try to respond to some questions that I heard this evening and some
good.
Concerns that Mr. Kennedy had indicated that some members of the board had, as well as I believe Mr. Butler had, with what I had attempted to do, especially in my August 29th letter addressed to Peter, which was forwarded to the board. Instead of trying to estimate by scientific means how many vehicle trips could be expected to use a connection or a second connection from this general area of the town out on to the Two Lights Road and ultimately back on to Route 77, what I attempted to do was to analyze a worst case condition so that we could look at the worst case, and if the worst case passed, then obviously anything less than that would be an improvement over the worst case. What I did was to take a traffic count, an existing traffic count, during the peak summertime hours at both Broad Cove and Route 77, and also at Route 77 and Two Lights intersections. We summarized that data and came up with the evening rush hour, which again is the highest and most critical hour, and again it's the hour of the day that traffic engineers typically analyze the impact of any development on the existing street system. With that information, I then estimated the number of trips that would be generated by a typical, at that time, 24-lot subdivision using standard engineering information to calculate those number of trips. I then tried to establish what I felt was the worst case condition that could develop by connecting a road, as indicated here this evening, back out on the Two Lights. And let me try to see if I can graphically describe it a little more closely than what I've tried to put in writing. I took the left turn out of Broad Cove and the right turn into Broad Cove and assumed that 75% of those two volumes of traffic would come down here and use this intersection. I took 50% of the right turn out and 50% of the left turn in at the same intersection and added it to this intersection. Obviously, to get to this intersection, that traffic has to pass through Two Lights and Route 77 intersection. If you look at numbers, I took half of the traffic that presently is on Broad Cove Road and I added it to Two Lights Road, passing it through that intersection. So an intersection that, and I'm assuming that you have my figure one there, shows 137 vehicles that presently use Broad Cove Road during the typical summertime, week time rush hour in the evening. It's made up of 57 vehicles that make a right turn coming out, 12 vehicles that make a left turn, 38 vehicles that make a left turn into Broad Cove, and 21 that make a right turn in. As I said, I took half of that traffic and reassigned it to the Two Lights Road, assuming that that certainly would represent a worst-case condition. The intersection that would be created by Farm Pond Road and Two Lights is not the intersection that's the heaviest impacted. The Two Lights Route 77 intersection is the one of concern because you're taking the traffic that's here and adding it to the traffic that's there plus what's on Route 77. I analyzed the intersection based on the information that I've explained using standard highway capacity calculation procedures, and the intersection exceeds the minimum design standards that are acceptable on urban arterials that are used nationwide. And I believe you see on the second page of my letter, the side street would have a level service of level service C, and the left turn from Route 77 into Two Lights would be at level service A, which is the highest and best level of service that's attainable. I would try to answer any questions mm-hmm. if I...
Gee, I have been dying to see you, Mr. Bray. On item 4, you state, the extension of Hunts Point Road to Two Lights Road will alter existing traffic flow. It is estimated that Broad Cove Road volumes will be reduced from 1,800 to 1,750 vehicles. That's only less 50 vehicles after this big road is built. And then you say, and Two Lights Road will increase from 1,757 to 2,287 vehicles daily. That's plus 530 extras.
Okay, I'm not sure where you're reading from.
I'm reading from this great big thing. It's called our preliminary plan application for the Highlands, and I would tell you what page, but it's sort of at the end of the book.
That was the original 1985 Bill Eaton report, I believe, Madam Chairman.
Well, I don't know. That's what it says.
Yeah, that was, I have a copy of it here. That was what was prepared by Bill Eaton for this project back in 1985.
Uh-huh. Well, if it was so old, I don't know why it was put back in here. Because is that changed now? You think that half the traffic that was on Broad Cove Road would be eliminated?
Well, it's certainly not going to vanish. The traffic that's on Broad Cove, again, if there's going to be any shift, is going to come over to Farm Pond Road. And I, you know, Mr. Eaton has presented it in one format, and mm-hmm. as I say, I've tried to present a worst-case condition.
Right, which
he's taken,
I appreciate.
He's taken half of the traffic off, and my procedures ended up taking half of the traffic off as well. I'm not taking it and throwing it out someplace else. It's actually going to end up coming over on Farm Pond Road.
Mm-hmm.
So that instead of having all of it come out Broad Turn, Broad Cove as it does now, it'll just simply be split between the two roadways.
Yeah, I know the rest of the people have questions, but I just have one more. Have you ever had a car counter out on Two Lights Road on a hot summer day? I called the state park a few weeks ago and was overwhelmed by the number of cars that use Two Lights Road for just the state park there.
I have never installed a 24-hour count on Two Lights. I can honestly tell you, because I was the one that took the count myself because of some work that we were trying to get done, mm-hmm. the day that the count at Two Lights and Route 77 was done was extremely warm.
Mm-hmm.
And there were a number of vehicles that were using that intersection to get down to the Two Lights area.
Mm-hmm.
But again, you keep in mind that we're looking at the rush hour at night, not what happens at 10 o'clock in the morning or 2 o'clock in the afternoon. We're looking
at a Saturday or a Sunday.
That's right, because your development traffic is much less on a Sunday and a Saturday than it is during the peak hour, during the week time, which is your typical commuter hours.
Well, I just think it would be very important to know how many vehicles truly use Two Lights Road, like on a hot Sunday afternoon.
We could certainly contact the state and see if they have some data that's available. I personally do not have any, and I'm not sure if anyone else is.
I would doubt that the state would have that data, since they don't even count cars that go into Two Lights State Park. I have to figure it out.
We could certainly check into it.
They count only people.
See if there's something available.
Any other questions? I don't want to usurp all the time. Judith?
I was going to make the same comment that you started to come up with, which is that from my own personal observations of Broad Cove and the point that the Broad Cove people have brought up, which is with respect to tourist traffic, this isn't your basic generic subdivision where you're just going to split up the cars. Broad Cove is where practically everybody that lives in Cape Elizabeth, when they have somebody visiting on a Saturday from out of town, let's go drive around Cape Elizabeth. And we can't go into Delano Park because they have all those private road signs, so we cruise through Broad Cove. Let's see the ocean and let's see the pretty houses, and isn't this nice where we live? And, so it's something different, and it's traffic that happens on weekends, and there's just that intangible thing that, if you go, you're driving around on a Saturday afternoon, it's 7 o'clock or it's a hot night, and you go up and get an ice cream and you're wasting time. I just want to know if that really is.
Let me see if I can answer it in a different way. What I've tried to do is I took all of the existing traffic on Two Lights Road,
mm-hmm.
and all of the traffic existing on Broad Cove Road. I believe I got it all, because there's only two ways into both of those locations, at least as far as I know, where the major traffic comes from in the core city. I've taken all of that traffic, and all I've simply done is reassign that traffic to try to develop the very worst case. I could take all the traffic that's on Broad Cove Road and put it over on two lights, and I still could get the intersection to work. Obviously, not all the traffic that comes out of Broad Cove today is going to flip over to two lights. So what I did was take about half of it and put over onto two lights. Now, I'm not sure how Farm Pond Road is going to encourage traffic to go down Two Lights Road. So I would assume that what's on Two Lights today is not going to increase because of this development. I don't disagree that there would possibly be occasional trips that people may meander through this way versus going up to Route 77. But I've already counted the traffic on Two Lights Road. It's already there. I'm not sure that this would be a development that would draw additional traffic someplace else in Cape Elizabeth to specifically come down to go to Farm Pond Road. So I believe, you know, with there's only two ways in, and I've counted all of those trips now, we know what that number is.
Any other questions from members of the board? Well, I've got one. The impacts on Hunts Point Road and Hunts Point Road Extension, I think, are going to be overwhelming. How would those be mitigated?
I traveled down here, and I tried to get down there during hours when I thought there may be a few children in the area, and mm-hmm. as well as a few parents that that may have gone out for reasons other than coming to and from work. And I tried to sit where that I wasn't obviously doing something that people would be concerned with. I just watched what was going on in the neighborhood, and there is some speeding right now that goes on the street. I don't think there's a question about that. Mm-hmm. I question how fast that traffic is. I would say that probably the average speed is somewhere between 30 and 35 miles an hour versus the posted speed of 25 miles an hour. Again, there's nothing short of dividing the street into little tiny pieces where you can reduce that speed down to 25 miles an hour. One thing that was done when Hunts Pond Road was constructed with Winding Way, they created a, if you want to call it, an artificial three-way intersection by taking Hunts Point Road and making that the T on the intersection versus creating Winding Way that way. And I've talked to Mr. Kennedy about possibly looking at doing the same type of a design down here where you regrade his proposed road and Hunts Point Road and make this leg of it as the T to the intersection, again trying to discourage traffic from using it as a through roadway. As far as controlling speed, it's, you know, something you can post it, but it's going to have to be enforced to be controlled.
Right. Thank you. Steve?
Just two quick questions, Bill. One, I understand that you looked at the two lights Route 77 intersection for your analysis. You did not look at any of the proposed Farm Pond two lights intersection. Is that correct?
No, but again, I looked at the worst intersection because everything that's here is up here, plus I've considered Route 77. I can do it, but the answers are going to be better than what I gave you for Route 77 and Two Lights Road because there's more traffic at that intersection.
That's something the board might want to look at. We can discuss. Other issue or other question is, can you translate the peak hour traffic figures into an average daily traffic count to put into real time?
You can if you want to make some very rough assumptions. Typically, the evening peak hour ranges between 8 and 12% of the daily traffic volume. In the area around Route 77 and Two Lights, I would suspect that percentage may be a little less than that, somewhere closer to the 7 to 9 range. I could see if we could find some daily traffic volumes and come up with a percent. But in an urban area, it ranges very close to 10%. The evening rush hour is of the total daily traffic flow.
Anyone else? Mr. Grabe, what about emergency accesses? I called COG a few weeks ago to ask them about a proposal. You probably heard me allude to it. You know, taking a narrower road and hooking it up to a wider road and making it an emergency road, but, you know, it would just be narrower. Have you heard of such a thing?
I guess there's all different types of design treatments that mm-hmm. you can come up with for emergency access. We've actually used where you have raised curbing so that if somebody wants to go over it, fire apparatus can go over the type 5 curbing, which is a slope curbing. But beyond that, you know, it wouldn't be accessible to vehicles. In all honesty, I think I would agree very much with what the town manager has stated, that it's very, very difficult to enforce the open use of those emergency access to perform what they're intended to perform. I guess my answer I'd like to give back to the board, and I really tried to study this enough so that I think I have a good feel for the area. Mm-hmm. I really don't see the traffic volume problem that is being discussed here this evening. I'm not going to state that there may not be additional traffic that comes in this way, but a lot of it are going to be the residents that live there. They're going to find it a heck of a lot easier to go to work by going out this way than to make the 1.8-mile trip all the way around Broad Cove and sit there and wait, you know, back 7 cars waiting to make the right turn out onto Route 77. But it's not going to be like a Bath Ironworks factory where you're going to generate, or the main mall where you're going to generate new traffic. You're going to have simply the traffic generated by the site and a reshift of the traffic that's already in that subdivision. Instead of people living down here on Channel View Road, and I don't recall all the names of the roadways down here, instead of having 2 cars go by their house, they may only have 1, because the other one's going to go out this way and come out 2 Lights Road. I really don't see a major draw or attraction to this subdivision by simply connecting out on the 2 Lights Road.
Thank you. Yes, Ivan.
Mr. Bray, can you just comment on the capacity of Broad Cove Road, the only entrance road right now, its capacity now, currently?
I certainly didn't calculate the capacity of the roadway back from the intersection, but I did look at the intersection at Route 77, and generally the intersection is what controls the capacity along the roadway. And much the same as it occurs at 2 Lights in Route 77, the intersection operates at acceptable urban standards during the peak hour in the evening. And again, that's your critical hour. I think there's certainly more of a concern with being able to access the area for emergency reasons versus simply accessing it for traffic circulation purposes.
Any other questions? Steve?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Bray, some of the comments tonight were on pedestrian traffic and children on Hunts Point Extension. Is there any, as a traffic engineer expert, is there any sense or any benefit to be gained from restricting the size of the street that's there now to include a sidewalk, or does the restriction of the road cause less maneuverability of traffic? Is there any benefit of putting a sidewalk in now?
I'm not sure what the right-of-way width along Hunts Point Road is, but I wouldn't encourage the board to recommend narrowing the pavement width. If you're going to look at putting a sidewalk in, I would recommend that you put that within the unbuilt section of the right-of-way versus narrowing the pavement width. I don't find that narrowing pavement width really achieves a great benefit in any regard.
What about those pretty strips that you can put down the middle with grass? Would that mitigate the speed?
Down the center of...
The center of a road, since this is like, they call it the airstrip.
It's an awful narrow roadway to try to divide up. I'm not sure exactly what the pavement width is, but I question if it's much over 25 28 feet wide right now.
Mm-hmm.
And to divide that up, you know, by making it narrower would be impossible for the street crews in the wintertime to maintain
right.
those roadways.
Madam
Thank
Chairman?
You. Yes.
I believe there is enough room, we'd have to check, but I believe there would be enough room within the right-of-way to put a sidewalk in if the board so,
mm-hmm.
so desired, and that might tie in with the re-subdivision issue, too. So if that's a concern of the board, that's at least one alternative. Mm.
But, of course, we have so many concerns. Well, if there are no further questions, we thank you so much, Mr. Bragg. And we will continue this this hearing in January, and we wish all of you a very happy holiday, and we'll see you in 1990. Thank you. Yeah, I was curious as to what kind of does the planning board want to take a 5-minute break before we, I mean, don't people have to go to the bathroom? What the name of the orchid was and whether it's an endangered species. Does anyone want to take a break and how she can verify that? What kind of ladies? Yeah, it's a difference whether they... The planning board will take a 5-minute break.
The drawings which you had are still applicable. It does not reduce the property. There's actually more paved area. The monument is the property line, in fact. The monument that was on the ground is, in fact, the property line.
Okay, to clarify it further, then as revised, it's something that the board doesn't have right now.
Change is that pin location?
The only change is the fact that the pin has the, what was known and shown as the poles is actually the pin, and so there's more land in front of the property. There's more town or city or MDOT property. MDOT property. That's the only change on that. Is everybody clear on that, or have I totally confused you all? Okay.
Mark, then make sure you don't get the confusion.
So that I understand it, Marion,
go ahead.
The only change between this and the one that was submitted for our package is the location of that property line.
The only change is that the property line has remained constant, and there is added property on the opposite side of the property line. There's no more property added to the Balfour piece of property.
So you still have 13 feet from the corner of the building to the boundary.
That's exactly right. The boundary perimeter has not changed. There is just more land that is town land outside of the property from the property line to the curb, if you will. There is more land.
Madam Chairman, may
yes,
I just...
Yes, go ahead.
It gets late, and that's why we shut off the agendas at 10 o'clock, understanding some of these things. Is the sidewalk in the same location on the two plans?
The sidewalk moves outward of the property line.
Okay, so the sidewalk is out further than it was before.
Correct.
There's a little... The parking area is a little more expansive than the... parking area plus the paved area that's not part of the applicant's park. The currently used parking area is expanded from what was shown before.
That's another way of phrasing it. The area within the boundary of the property line, those are exactly the same.
Right. So there's nothing on the side changes, the sidewalk changes, that's in the entrance, curves out.
But the question, I guess, we'll still get back to is the buffering question that Mr. Tinkman asked originally. What have you done in the area of buffering other than those views that look like are opposite the new second-story addition? Is there anything else that you've done?
The buffering is, at this point in time, was still as proposed originally with the grass stripping in here. Okay, we were not going to propose a buffering. We've talked to the abutter on that side, and he had made agreement. If it is the desire of this board to provide additional plantings here along there, Mr. Balfour has said that he would comply with that, work that out, and what we would request tonight is a conditional, is an approval on the application with a condition attached to the application or to your approval that certain kinds of plant material would be approved, but we would like to get the project underway for construction so that he's in the slow period, and the longer this is delayed for him, the more hardship it becomes.
Have you been made aware of a letter from Henry C. Adams from the Main Street 90 committee?
Yes,
concerning,
I have a copy of it.
Buffering of your area between the parking lot and the sidewalk. He says, this buffer zone could either be on the applicant's property or in consonance with the town on the town sidewalk. An appealing display along the sidewalk of low shrubs would be ideal and further the common goal.
I have two concerns about that. Is how high will that shrubbery grow at some point in time to obscure an important traffic corner? And two, I would have the concerns of maintaining that landscaping during the winter months when the snow is piled as high as it is now, considering you're in between, you know, you're taking all the snow off the street, and there's going to be a lot of damage in here to that kind of planting. Mr. Balfour is not opposed to providing planting in that area, and it could be worked out if that is the wish of this of the planning board.
Anyone care to comment on that? Dick?
Madam Chairman, the Main Street 90 committee is a wonderful little committee with lots of nice ideas, and I know that they talked about this as a full committee the other night, and they feel very strongly about it. Their recommendations for the town center will be coming to the town shortly, and it will deal with a lot of substantive issues, not only design function, but aesthetics as well. And this is a very important corner. Regardless of what we do tonight, we should not only encourage but require landscaping that takes a very important corner in the town and provides a substantial level of landscaping, to the extent that it can be protected over the winter months and that it's appropriate for the particular location that it's in, has got to be something that's worked out by professionals.
Yeah.
And as long as those professionals and our planner agree to that, I wouldn't mind personally approving with very strong conditions, and the intent of the board is to have a very intensive landscaping program, even if it's on an annual basis in that corner.
Mm-hmm.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
Even though Mr. Tinsman suggests that perhaps we're all swimming into a state of somnolence, my neighbor to my left is quite awake and made a suggestion about the landscaping that might be a possible solution, which would be to set out boxes with landscaping that could be removed during the winter months, and that would take care of a situation, making it look attractive for as long as possible.
I think there's a willingness on the part of Mr. Balfour to cooperate. If I'm not speaking out of turn for you, Scott, but I believe that he is more than willing to cooperate with both the Main Street 90 group as well as...
It goes beyond Main Street 90. You know, on page 20 of our... regulations, it's section 19-1-something on buffering. It requires, it says buffering should be located around the perimeter of the site to minimize the effects of headlights, of vehicles, noise, etc. So it's right there.
You're suggesting then that the plantings be higher than the lights of the cars so that it would protect the cars then, and we're going to provide that kind of buffering on this corner?
No, I'm just saying should be.
I think we're looking at an aesthetic issue that is well beyond what buffering is intended to be.
I've got a comment, too, as long as we're on this, just because you're responding, I'd like you to factor in my thoughts, too. I think you're hearing from the planning board that we're very concerned about how this looks. This should be a simple project. I frankly thought we were going to get a landscaping plan tonight. I have trouble, given the fact that this is our one shot at a very focal part in Cape Elizabeth, figuring out anything from those sort of schematics. and I'm uncomfortable, unless we have an extremely strong condition, with anything other than a landscaping plan that shows us what it would look like. It seems to me that, you know, I don't want to make life more difficult, but you seem to be resisting, and you keep saying that you want to do some of these things. I'd like to see what it looks like, frankly, because this is the focal point, literally, of the center of town, and it's just not enough to have a couple little circles, to me anyway. I would really like to see some kind of a drawing so we get an idea of just how creative you are willing to be and not let this thing go with tugging and hauling and back and forth over whether it's going to be 6 inches or 8 inches or 3 or 9. I'd really like to see what it's going to look like so that we can tell ourselves and the rest of the town we did a good job on that very focal corner point. And I'm not getting that sense at all. I'm just sort of getting, you know, we come back with a plan, we'll let you go, we'll see a few more circles on that. And I really think you need to do that. And maybe you can do that very quickly.
I agree, Dan. It will be up to the planning board if they want to take this further and have a public hearing in regard to it, since we did receive the letter from Henry Adams and an additional letter from Jerry and Sharon Murray regarding stormwater. They are abutters and are very concerned about that, and I'm sure that the board would like to know what is going to happen to the stormwater, and I think snow might be a problem too. So does the board wish to have a public hearing on this the next time? And that would give you time to plans.
I, for one, I don't feel a public hearing is really called for here. I really do agree with Dan, though, that we need something more detailed than we have right now. Something with some elevations that we could really see, like from a road, what it would look like. This is a plan view, and it gives you some information, but it doesn't give me a sense of what this is going to look like when I drive around the corner, which I drive around every single day. Right now, it's a corner that looks like you can almost access from any point. It's even hard to tell where the curb cut is right now. I would like to see something better than we have here. I'm not sure if public hearing is called for.
Madam Chairman, I'm speaking as a non-voting member in this issue, but I agree. I don't think we need a public hearing, but what we're looking at, and I think we can all visualize the granite parking curbing, and I don't think that's what any of us had in mind for a visual impact on that corner. I think we really need to see what it's going to look like.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. Good point, Steve. And also, Mr. Bray is here. It appeared from what I read, the traffic report, that there weren't any problems. Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Bray?
Madam Chairman, yes. I just have a quick question for Mr. Bray. Bill has done a couple of projects in this intersection the last couple of years. I believe he did the Cumberland Farms application several years ago and made certain recommendations at that time, and you've done others as well around this intersection. What have you seen in the last couple of years, and what does that intersection need, if anything?
Well, as I had indicated in the letter that I had prepared for Mr. Belfour, the accident rate really hasn't changed that much. Obviously, the traffic is just continually increasing each year. I truthfully believe that signalization of that intersection is in the very near future. And when I say signalization, I mean fully sequenced traffic lights. I think the traffic volumes are very, very close right now, if not already exceeding the minimum warrants for installing traffic lights. And if the town hasn't looked at that, I would strongly recommend that that be looked at in the near future, because I feel, based on what I've seen over, well, it's been almost 3 years now, that number is very, very close to what the minimum requirements are for traffic signals.
Thank you.
This is an opportunity we have to talk not only about this application, but what he sees with this application. Right. It relates maybe to some landscaping. If we had a fully signalized intersection, we sort of have a broad open sweeping intersection now, at least in front of
the applicant's property where it comes out between Cumberland Farms and this property, and it's just a wide-throated area. Could you see closing that up at all if we would go to a signalized intersection?
I honestly haven't given enough thought in that regard to really respond to you with any good judgment at this point. I would think it would depend on what type of signals that you install there, whether they be an actuated type where that they'd work off of vehicle demand or whether they just strictly work off a time of day. Again, I'm not sure if there's a real strong need to have some pedestrian lights in the intersection. And if that's the case, then you might want to look at it somewhat differently as well. Obviously, when the state constructed that, they constructed those sweeping radiuses for a reason. I'm not sure what the reason was because I wasn't around when they designed it, but it exists on all the corners of the intersection. But it doesn't appear, if you look at the accident trends, it doesn't look like that those radiuses are a cause of the accidents that are occurring in the intersection. It doesn't appear that that is a problem, at least from an accident standpoint.
Okay. Anyone else?
I wonder how we can determine. I mean, this is a rather unusual winter so far. I guess actually we really haven't gotten to winter. But how can we determine whether there is enough space allotted here for a snow depository? Do we leave that to our town
engineers
to eyeball it and take the square?
Maybe Mr. Valley.
More public works director. If you take the amount of snow that's been just that we've seen to this point in time, I think it might raise some questions. I mean, you can see it firsthand. You don't need public works director to see it.
Well, I think it's an important factor, and I just wonder how we assess that. And maybe you've got an answer.
I would assume that we would the same thing with this applicant as most people. If you run out of room and there's no place to move it, you're going to have it hauled away. Get a backhoe in there and get it out. I mean, it just is all of us have kind of unlimited, don't have unlimited plowing areas. I know 4 years ago in our own home, we came to the point where if we had another couple of feet of snow, we'd have been out of room, we'd have to have a backhoe to come in.
Now, what about the problem brought up by Mr. and Mrs. Murray, the abutters, concerning stormwater runoff into their yard, which is flooding their yard? Where is your stormwater going to?
I don't think Darren Abutter Scott has heard from, I believe. I'd like to have him address that.
Okay, great. Thank you. See, if we can get these things out of the way, then
right. We
can go forward.
So Murray's being such long-term residents of Cape Elizabeth, when he expressed concern or told me a problem he had, I gave it more than the normal weight. I think the Bill Jordans, the Murrays, whatever, are those types of people that deserve that. They've been in town longer than most of us here. The issue is he is way down here. He's not in a butter. In fact, you've got to go quite a way down a private street before you reach to his house. But apparently he has water in his front yard. Mm-hmm. And he's had water in his front yard. I was hoping he'd be here tonight for years and years and years and years and years. So I think the question is, two, are we aggravating that in any way?
Right.
And we are proposing only 50 more square feet of impervious area here, mm-hmm. and we're more than offsetting it by here. So there's a net loss. Or a net gain from his perspective. So that addresses, does this application hinder or create a bigger problem than that's existed for over 20 years here? The next question is, can we simply take care of it? And not without pushing water uphill. A lot of his problem has, it comes straight down the private road here. Mm-hmm. It comes off of Ann and Jim McCullum's land. Yeah. Over here, and it's just been that way forever. So it's something, though, I sympathize with his position. I've walked it with him, and I said, how can we do this, and we really can't without pushing the water uphill, because most of the problems are not addressed from our property. So the question is, do we further aggravate it? And the application does not.
And could I just ask you, when you did walk it with him, the letter is dated December 12th.
The letter?
After the letter was sent? Or did you walk with them before December 12th?
Let me ask, I believe, your question. You met Mrs. Sharon, and one of you met Sharon in the store and discussed it?
In the grocery
store.
I saw her, and she...
Yes.
She told me about it, and I said, take a letter over to the town hall. So this letter
is probably afterwards.
December 12th.
That's probably after I met him.
Well, she says that we feel that the time has come when the storm water should be channeled directly to the proper storm drains rather than diverted over our private property.
Right. We're not diverting any water over their property with this application. It's conditions from the whole neighborhood, and... not being aggravated here. I do sympathize with their problem.
Well, we'll have to.
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
This is second floor, 468 square foot application. Mm-hmm. There are very few site changes being proposed other than those that have been required by the town, specifically in parking, delineation, curb cuts, and now the outstanding question on landscaping, and at least I've indicated that I'd be willing to have staff review that. I've heard other board members say that the planning board should be scrutinizing that application, and I guess I agree with that would like it to come back to the planning board. I'm concerned by the level of scrutiny maybe that we give certain applications and not others, that this is the second floor. There's a little... I'm not even sure more intensively used as a site. I think it'll look better with the second floor on it. The massing of the building on the site and on the corner, I think, is a more attractive building. And I think when this planning board gets through the landscaping plan, then it's going to aesthetically be a much more attractive location in the town as an important corner. And I think it'll be safer than it is right now with an open-throated entrance to Route 77 in the intersection. I'm not so sure, because maybe I've sat on the other side of planning board presentations before. What we can do as a planning board with snow removal. I hear the issue, and I sympathize with the town's perspective that they push a lot of snow up there, and these guys push a lot of snow back, and whose snow is it? But I guess I don't have a lot of sympathies with trying to get an applicant to get a bigger area in a site for snow storage when he doesn't have any other area for snow storage. So I'm not sure that... I'm not concerned about that. They've shown a snow storage area, and I think that's good. I think it's good to address the issue and to start pushing snow one way rather than pushing it out in the street, which is illegal. We have neighbors down the road that have a stormwater, and as Mr. Balfour indicated, there's a stormwater problem in the area. I don't see how adding 468 square feet on the second floor adds to the stormwater problem, and I don't think that an applicant, personally, should be required to fix up a neighborhood problem by proposing a second story 468. So I guess I'm concerned that we're trying to solve neighborhood problems or town problems with this 468 square foot application. I felt compelled to say that. And at the same point, I would move to table until the next meeting for a landscaping review.
I agree, and I think that someday we must discover if snow really is the purview of the planning board, because it seems that I haven't ever seen anything about snow and
I think that it is when it can be solved, and I think and when you get something brand new happening and you reserve spaces for that, we just unless we put it on the second floor,
right.
I don't know that we got.
It seems like more a staff problem than a problem of the planning board. Well, second to table. Any discussion on that? All in favor of tabling, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It is unanimous.
And I think the clear message is that we'd like to be done with this thing, but we really want to say that that's a heck of a pretty landscaping plan, and it's really catchy, and we like it. So err on the side of being creative, and we'll be done with it.
One question I would like to ask the board in terms of delineation in response, Steve, to your letter. Intentionally, we had not striped the parking lot for aesthetic reasons so that it did not look commercial. If the board would see other ways of perhaps small signs that would number what's that? We'll address it next time.
They should know that there is a condition here that was suggested by staff for striping, and I think that the zoning board had the requirement for striping, or at least the one that I read in our package.
I think the zoning board was told that the spaces would be striped.
Right. That's what I read in the minutes.
We'll check the minutes.
Well, we thank you, and do I hear a motion to adjourn?
Second. All in favor, say aye.
I was going to say, you may want to talk about the January 2nd workshop, however.
Oh, I think...
Unless people all really want to go, but we may need to...
Don't you think we should...